Guys, good evening, Shreyas. So today what we will do, we'll talk about a couple of other basics. AWS, what where we left yesterday. BCDR as a service, and also said infrastructure as a code. We'll talk about these two terms, and then we'll see what all the things that we can discuss within the AWS. Okay, so when we are saying BCDR as a service, business continuity disaster recovery as a service, means let's say customer is having his own data center. Okay, and he don't want to migrate, or he don't want to shut down the data center and migrate the services onto AWS or any other cloud platform. Since he want to retain his own data center at first point. Okay, and what he'll have some sort of backup solution. Okay, some sort of backup solution within on the premise. What it does, it will take a backup of existing infrastructure and store in local. When I say store in local, some sort of storage that will be used to store the backups in local itself. Okay, let's say customer has around 1,000 odd servers. Okay, out of which, let's say, few full stack applications are there. The full stack applications in the mean, you have a database, you have an application, and you have a web front. Okay, so these systems also part of the backup. So what customer is expecting, let's say, if I adopt cloud as a DR location, in that case, your AWS will act as DR. Okay. Within the AWS, which service you will use mostly? You will use a service called S3 for data dumps, or sometimes if you go to Azure, you will use storage accounts or recovery service vault, these two things in Azure as a medium. So what happens? Data will be replicated onto these components. So let's say data will be backed up via backup solution to here, and whenever there is a leisure time, it will replicate onto cloud. Okay, and the customer has agreed business as per business or agreed SLA or agreed recovery plans or something. As per agreement, they have to conduct DR drills or BCDR activity 6 months, every 6 months at least once. Okay, in that case, what happened during the DR activity? We will deploy backup agent here, or backup cloud agent, I'll say. Okay, and in turn it will go and connect to the same backup solution only. Okay, and it will read the data from this storage and recreate your full stack. Means your three-tier application will be recreated here with the agreed point in time. In that case, what happens if you are trying to access the applications from on-premise? Okay, you'll ask your customers to connect to cloud machine, saying application should function from your cloud for the particular 1 or 2 days. If everything is working normal, then you will say your on-premise business has a DR which is in cloud. Okay, and you don't want to keep this business in the cloud. Only when there is any disaster happened, you would like to adopt the cloud as a quick recovery medium. The rest of the business will stay within on-premise.
So Shri, one question here. In the second panel where you draw three things, one is recovery service vault, then B agent, and then the third component. Now, after my first on-premises gets resumed, then the third, which is created on demand, will that be there or will it be deleted?
It will be there. All these components will be there. They are active for 365 days. Okay, what happens? Whatever the data that is being saved here, the extra copy, we will save it here.
Okay. Yeah, copy is okay, but that third one which got created, like where the customers are going now to cloud.
This one, right? This one.
Yeah.
No. This stack will not be there. We will delete that after the DR drill. Okay.
It's our responsibility.
That will be there. That will be there in active condition. In the sense, this application has active replication in cloud, then it will be there.
Okay. Thank you.
Otherwise, we don't keep these resources. Only the data dumps will be maintained, the two encrypted data. So even if somebody is trying to read it, they can't read it unless until they get that backup agent to read the data.
Okay. Thank you.
And one more point is infrastructure as a code. Okay, when I say infrastructure as a code, Shreyas, any idea? Gopal?
No, Shrini.
No.
Okay, so when I talk about infrastructure as a code, which means, let's say, in traditional way, if I have traditional infrastructure within my on-premise running on VMware, okay, if the infrastructure is running on VMware, so what I will do as part of my day-to-day activity, I'll log in the morning, I'll perform the health checks, and there are certain tasks I can do, and also part of the day-to-day, I need to create a couple of virtual machines in day-to-day basis. When I say in day-to-day basis, the customers will always request 1 or 2 machines that needs to be deployed in a day-to-day. In that case, if you are normally deploying a machine, let's say it is taking normally half a day. Let's say half a day for complete work. Okay, how to minimize this? Then the people start using concept called templates. Templates will have all the configuration predefined. Only you have to select the template and go and deploy it. What it will do, it will create exact true copy of the same machine which is already there in the template, and you can simply change the IP, change the settings, and hand out to the customer within 30 minutes. Okay, or maybe less than that. So these templates will contain the pre-configured parameters like how much CPU, how much RAM, and how many NIC cards, how many hard disk, and what could be the IP address, what could be the VLAN and stuff. These things you can incorporate within the template, just to minimize the manual efforts within the traditional VMware. Okay, if I look at the same concept in cloud, let's say I want to deploy virtual machine, I want to deploy a load balancer, I want to configure both of them, in the sense configure the load balancer with the backend pool as a virtual machine and test the front end of traffic. These are the things on a day-to-day I'll need the setup. Let's say I need at least two servers every day, and both of them are connected to on a load balancer. And on the back end, the DB is platform as a service component. Okay, we'll connect to the same DB. And the setup we need every day in the morning, 9 o'clock, and evening, 6 o'clock, even if you disrupt, not an issue. Okay, so what kind of requirement it is? Let's say the cloud is adopted by a pure developer company. Okay, they have few developers who works on their modules or their sprint releases, right? Part of their development, they need this setup to be up and running every day morning till evening. That's it. Once the testing or once the day-to-day activities are done, okay, and there is no real usage of the system. Okay, in the evening they don't use, hardly people will use it unless until they don't have some testing requirement, they don't have some UAT requirement. Otherwise it can be deleted. In that case, they can't hire one admin saying, boss, every day morning you go and deploy these servers for me, and evening you just shut down it or just delete it. Okay, so what they will do, part of their day-to-day activity, they will write some sort of code, infrastructure as a code. Okay, some sort of code in the form of JSON or in the form of YAML, or the now people are calling it as Terraforms. Okay, so if you are deploying this code, what you call it as, if you are deploying any of such code in AWS, there is a technical word, call it as cloud formation template. Okay, if you deploy something in AWS, it will be in a cloud formation template. The cloud formation template might be in JSON format or might be in ML format. Both will work. Okay, and what about the Terraform? Terraform will have its own syntax and its own command set. You can write it, and if you execute it, it will create again a cloud formation template and it will automatically deploy. But only thing is, if you can write a code in Terraform, the Terraform code you can easily modify and use it for Azure or GCP or traditional on-premise VMware or Nutanix, any other virtualization platform, you can deploy the resources by using Terraform. Okay, so what they will do, they'll simply write some instructions that can spin up whatever the required infrastructure within the Azure or within the AWS based on their day-to-day need, that you call it as infrastructure as a code. You write a script that will automatically deploy the infrastructure for you, and you go ahead with your day-to-day activities like your code testing and all. Once done, you just simply type destroy. It will automatically destroy everything, and in the morning you can again run the same script. The machines will be ready in 10 minutes, so that what you can do, you can save 70% of your billing. Only Monday to Friday, 9 to 6, you're running the machines, rest all free, rather than keeping the machines for 24/7. Understood? Any questions on this?
Shrini,
Yeah.
I got a question there. So every time we execute this CloudFormation template, so every time it's like building a new server, right?
Exactly.
So
So the
whatever the data if I
data
have,
is
right,
leased
it will
water.
get
Yeah.
lost.
No. We don't keep it for our production environment. We will keep it for development and testing environment. Production 24/7, it is already up and running. We don't touch the production very frequently. Right?
Got it.
So people are working on development space. They need a server or they need an application on a day-to-day, morning to evening. After evening, they don't require it because they have their code in GitHub, they have their code in Azure repository somewhere else. So the data won't be lost because the code is actually sitting on somewhere else.
Understood. Right.
So next question is, let's talk about AWS basics. In the sense, within AWS, what all the things that basically we need to understand before we go ahead and do the testing. Okay, so I guess you guys already know what is AWS region and what is AWS availability zones. Let me know, else I'll explain. Gopal, Shreyas, Vamsi. No, yes. You want me to explain? We'll go and discuss about.
AWS region might be like a data center on one side and on the data center on the other side, something like
Exactly.
that.
Yeah. Okay, let's go ahead and discuss briefly, not go in detail. Let's say I have my own on-premise somewhere in US or in India or in UK anywhere. Okay. And I have my delivery centers across it. When I say delivery centers, these are all remote offices. Okay, and if you look at these are already connected together. Okay, these are already connected together in a private network. How? Via site-to-site VPN or MPLS, some other mechanism, they are all connected together. So in this case, if you are trying to introduce AWS into your existing business, okay, if it is a new enhancement, we still need to decide if it is. Existing business, what I will do, I need to identify where this on-prem DC is located. Okay, near to this, I need to identify location for AWS. Nearby location for AWS. The reason is you have an infrastructure which is hosted in your data center. Okay, if you want to take that and move the data, move the business, or move the infrastructure, it will take ages. If you are, let's say I have an infrastructure in US, in one data center, and you're trying to replicate or move the data and the whole business into AWS in Mumbai, practically it is not going to work. Okay, one, there are two things here. One is your latency or your bandwidth or your business constraints. You don't want to fall under this problem. And the second one is the data sovereignty laws which are in place, if it is GDPR controlled in UK or Europe region, you can't take the data of your business or any sort of business into any country, or in short, you can't take the data out of your country. You need to keep within the UK or within the Europe as per GDPR. Similarly, certain rules are applicable for Middle East as well, and certain rules are applicable for US as well. So for that reason also, you can't simply ship the data or ship the business across the globe unless until it is a country specific, or it is what I can say, the latency applicable. So in that case, what I need to do, I need to identify the nearby location for my business within the USA. So technically what we call it as AWS region. The region is, okay, geolocation where AWS has its DC, or I'll say DC or DCs. It will not be one DC. There have multiple data centers within that city. Okay. In the sense, let's say I have one region called West US. Okay. West US is the region. So let me go to my portal. And if I click on North Virginia here, you will see all these regions are popped up here. I'll say US West 1. Okay, now if you see, your URL has been changed to US West 1 console.aws.com. That means if you keep on changing your preferable location where you want to deploy or manage your infrastructure, that will keep on changing, and your portal will be accessible from that local region. Okay, whatever the listed regions here, these are the available, currently available geo locations or data centers what AWS has across the globe. Okay, now what I'm saying is, there is another small concept called availability zones. Availability zones means, I've clearly said here, geolocation where AWS has its own DCs, not a single DC, multiple data centers. Okay, so if I select West US, and what I will do, I will go to network. And subnet. If I see, I have only two locations. Means in West US currently two data centers or two buildings are there. Like this. If I say West US is collection of two buildings. Okay, and similarly, now I want to deploy something on East US, where majorly people will deploy the resources or do the business. East US, if you see availability zones, you have a six availability zones. Means East US region is currently running with six different buildings like this. Each building will act as an individual DC. The building will be in the same city, might be in extreme corners or somewhere else within the same street. We never know. But they have six different buildings like this. Understood? And all of these are interconnected. All of these are interconnected in the sense they have adequate bandwidth connectivity or a dark fiber connectivity on the back end within the same city. Okay, let's say you logged into your portal and you have a requirement, you simply deploy a server here. Okay, you deployed one server. The server has a backend disk. The disk will be replicated into two more locations all the time, just to provide high availability. Even if an entire building goes wrong, after a certain time, you will see your machine will automatically up and running in another location, okay, within a given time. Let's say 1 hour is the SLA, or 99.95 is the SLA for standalone virtual machine. For some reason, if the entire machine is gone, you are unable to access it due to some issue in the building or issue in the data center itself, which you have hosted in AWS. So what happens after a certain time, you don't need to do anything, it will automatically start functioning from another zone within a given SLA, maybe 45 minutes or 1 hour, whatever. Okay, you don't want to face those kind of downtimes, unnecessary downtimes. What you can do, you can design your solutions in high availability compatibility mode, high availability mode, I'll say. You can deploy two resources or two machines or two services in two different zones and connect with some load balancing mechanism, and users can access both the servers in round robin fashion. What happens even if one server is gone due to some hardware failure or due to some downtime occurred on building a rack or power supply, whatever, still you can access your resources from the other side. In that case, your impact is 50%, or at least you will run with 50% of your active resources during the disaster. So for that reason also, you can adopt the zones concept. So the advantage is they have a backend connectivity, whatever the data that you are saving here. So if you want to replicate the data, it can replicate back easily. Okay, the same thing, let's say I have one more region, let's say in UK. So I can keep one server here and I can keep one other server here. So if something you're trying to replicate, this is a bit difficult. This is latency involved replication or latency involved data syncing. So the feasible option is zone concept. So if something goes wrong, if you want a quick turnaround times or quick recoveries, so availability zones will be serving these functionalities for global customers. Okay, and also I'm talking about just customer services. Now if you go back to AWS and scroll down, you see how many number of services are there? More than 200, right? What is these services? These are also a software piece or software components which are running in those data centers. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's say you created some application. You created some serverless application. That serverless application is deployed here. For some reason, your serverless application and your data, you just kept it outside. Let's say in GitHub, you have your code and you have a Jenkins, which is deployed in Mumbai EC2 instance. Okay, And from Jenkins, you will always push your data or code into this application hosted in East US. Okay, for some reason, this application or a function is not working. It's dead in this particular location. The particular service is not working. So what happens? The service is spread across multiple buildings. Their internal service, I'm saying, spread across multiple buildings. So the moment this region or this zone is not functioning or the service is impacted, so a service can easily replicate. Let's say the service Lambda function will be used by more than 8,000 customers at the moment, active customers in this location, and all of them are impacted for 2 minutes. So AWS can't simply sit relaxed and wait for the failure to happen and restart the services on the other location and let the 8,000 active customers face the impact. They can't sit and impact the customers like that, right? So what they will do, they'll simply have their own services replicated across multiple zones. So the moment the one zone is completely dead, automatically services will fail back onto other zone. Otherwise, if you log into your portal and you go to some of your services, if the zone is dead, if you click on the service, you will not see no components found. Then what you will say? Right. So at least if the server is down, that's fine. Server is down. We'll wait until the server is up and running. But that server must show you in the screen. Shut down, terminated, or unknown. But something it should show. Otherwise, what happens? Your server itself is missing in the inventory in your portal. So that should not happen, right? So how that inventory is maintained? It has its own service in the backend to do the inventory and add it to your portal. So if the inventory itself is down, the customers won't accept it. So what AWS will do, AWS has its own internal services which needs to be replicated across all the zones. So even if something goes wrong, those services will automatically fail back, or those services will automatically start functioning from the other zones, so that customers won't face those kind of issues on their front end, including the service notations, including backend services both. This is a front-end GUI, right? So the backend services also must be up and running in order to view this GUI here.
Okay.
Agreed? So these kind of things that you can achieve through availability zones. Yeah. Tell me.
Yeah, I just noticed one thing in the user interface. They are showing availability zone, but just like I have seen in Azure, availability sets. So is it there in AWS, or it's because availability?
No, it's purely Azure concept. Availability
okay.
zone. Availability zone is a concept in AWS. There is no concept called availability set.
Got it. And. One of the, as you said, that all of these are services and are highly available. But just yesterday, I read one article that SNS services provided by AWS are down since last 24 days. So is it because of this, it is not available in any region, or it's because of internal their problem?
No. The whole service is impacted. Okay, mm-hmm. it's not due to the region down. It's if a region down, or if the zone complete, if the complete zone is down, then you will see multiple services got impacted. So the SNS service has some internal development issue or some internal bugs or some internal exposes. So that particular service is impacted. Okay,
uh-huh.
And if you look at another article. The UK South region in Azure has impacted in September. If you guys have seen.
Yeah. Have
right?
you shown that? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I've shown that, right? So for others, UK South Azure down. Cooling loss causes outage at Microsoft Azure UK South data center. When? September 15th, in this month only. Okay, for 2-3 days, all the customers are impacted in UK South within Azure. Means the whole region is down. It's not down. Users are unable to access the resources, or users are unable to view the resources in that particular region. Okay, so
Got
those
it.
kind of situations will arise surely in AWS as well near future. You can't say the AWS system is very stable and Azure systems are not stable. So it happens. Okay, and you see sometime before AWS DDoS attack in 2020.
Yeah.
Okay, somebody is trying to attack with 2.3 TB of DDoS to bring your console.aws.com down, just to break that console. So they will not be able to, but this is what the recent attack, 2.3 terabytes. Okay, these kind of stuff will always be there, and you will see sometimes what happens, some of the services that they're doing some upgrades and stuff, those services will impact from the back end. Okay, so those things will have to keep in mind. According to those SLAs, you need to work upon how to restore your services on a different data center or different region, or within the region in a different zone, how you can replicate and access the resources. Those things you need to keep in mind when you're deploying something in any public cloud, not only Azure or not only AWS.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay. So there is another portal called infrastructure.aws. If you guys look into. Okay. Let's say this will clearly show you global regions, okay, data centers in US, right? Availability zones, you see, they will give you simple clear cut instructions, what is what and how they are interconnected. Let's say I have a region in Mumbai, okay, with three availability zones, means within a Mumbai they have a three buildings for replication or for high availability. Okay, so you see the blue ones, availability zones. So within Mumbai they have a two availability zones, and the third one is actual service. It is sitting on this back end of this image. Okay, three zones. So the blue one is here, the one is here, and the one is here. Similarly, you pick any global region, North Virginia, you see it has six zones, means six different buildings within the North Virginia. And let's say Canada Central, three different buildings like that. Okay, it will give you how these are interconnected, right? How these are interconnected, how the data is being exchanged. And apart from that, you will see how this network flow is showing up. And POP, they don't have a data centers. These are edge locations. Okay, all these are edge locations. The pink ones, it shows the edge locations across the globe. You see, in Mumbai, I have AWS region, in Delhi, and in Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad. These are point of presence. Okay, what this point of presence will do? Okay, to let's say you are accessing your Prime videos, right? So for public from north, they will connect to point of presence which is deployed in Delhi, and south you have three different locations. The nearby people, they will go and access the content from those points. Okay, I'm just giving an example how this point of presence will work. This Prime Video is one of the example. Similarly, if a customer is trying to access something and he want to do the CDN for his own business, content delivery network for his own business, so these are the four point of presences within India if he want to access the content in local area or in the nearby location. Like that, you have a point of presences in every region. Okay, see, point of presence in Middle East, or I don't know what country it is. Yeah, you see multiple these ones are point of presence. They don't have any data center. They will have some edge where they will have the connectivity, and they will replicate or cache the data over there so that people can access it easily from that point. Okay.
So Shri, from this diagram, what I understood is, if I want high availability, then I will go with availability zones. But if I want disaster recovery, then I will go with regions, right?
Yes.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay. So availability zones are local quick restores, local quick recoveries. In the sense, within a fraction of a second, I want to see my business is up and running. And for that, high availability, you will use availability zones. High availability means not the 100% uptime. As much as we can, we try to keep our business up and running. There might be 1 or 2 hours downtime in a year. That needs to be accepted. If a disaster happened, okay, if entire region, it's a hypothetical, if entire region is gone, means all the 6 buildings are gone at a time, then you will think about business continuity and disaster recovery.
Yeah, because they are located so close, I don't think it is 300 miles away or what.
No. Zones will be in the same street, might be on the same building, or might be on the same compound in a different building.
Okay.
Zone means within the same city. Within the same city, let's say you have some IT says, where you have three different buildings can act as three different zones. Because building one is running with separate power supply supplied by Tata, and different building two is supplied by your Maharashtra state government, and building three by Adani. Three different power supplies for three different buildings, and each one is redundant for other buildings. And also, the cooling is different, the network connectivity is different, everything is different, because three buildings will act as a three different individual entities. So that if someone is doing a strike, someone is doing some impact, at least you can do your alternate business model, not depending on those particular entities. Right? Mm-hmm. So for that, these zones will help you. So zones will be on a same city. You never know, they might be on a same building, or might be on a same street, or might be on across the city, or within the city, across different corners. That we don't know, because if you see the representation, you'll see that blue circle. That's it. You never know what is that location, what is that building. Even if you go there geographically, there is no board. This is a AWS data center. No, they will not see any boards like that.
Okay.
Right. So, guys, from where we should start now? You guys have an account? Yeah.
Yes, here, got a question. Does price changes depending on if we choose availability zone or region, or it will be same?
I like a fossil watch. Okay, whenever you're coming to India, please bring one fossil watch, because from there you will get it for $40. I need to purchase it here with 16,000. Can you help me? Same thing.
No, my question was not in that way. Let's say in the US, right?
Understood what I'm trying to say. Right?
I got your question. I got your sense, but what my question was, like in US, there are certain ways, certain things, there are only regions, right? And in west there might be availability zones. So if I build my infra in west where there is no availability zone but just a region, right? So price
Yeah.
in that particular
No,
region,
the
is it going to be same as?
price depends on the region. Okay, let's say within the US you have a four or five regions. Okay, so now understand, in US East one, so million customers are active and business is huge and business is running perfectly. So I can give discounts to customers who are using East US or North Virginia, what I want to say, right? And West US, people are hardly using it. I have deployed world-class hardware over there. I'm spending same amount which I spend on my East US, but customers are not using that much. So I'm wasting my money. So how to do a recovery? Let just increase a bit fraction in the costing, or in a different way. Because it's hard to understand the cost model of the public cloud. It is all flexible. So if you're trying to fly, I mean, trying to book a flight, whenever you refresh it, the price will automatically increase it. The logic says there is a demand, please increase it. It is also same.
Okay, got it.
Got it.
Right. So you will see price variations across the regions. On what basis those price variations are coming up, I'm not 100% sure. I'm just hypothetically saying that depends on how much revenue that they are getting out of their investment. That decides the how much price that they want to set that particular resource or set that particular resource in that particular location. If you deploy the same sort of EC2 instance in across the globe, you will see different prices for different locations. The reason is the business model and the cost model what they have adopted to serve you better in that particular locations, they need that much cost. That's what my understanding is, because there's no granular level or no document evidence how this billing works, because that's their proprietary property they won't share with us, right?
Got it.
That one thing we need to keep in mind. Considering all those stuff, you need to design your solutions for customers. Okay, so one more thing is, you guys have to set up your own account. If you have your own account, it's okay. Otherwise, please enroll for yourself and keep one account ready for practice day to day. Okay, so you need to provide your credit card details. Okay, what I did, I've provided my credit card details, and let's say, okay, I've provided my credit card details and I removed a credit card later on. Billing payment method, say. So what I did, I've added my credit card, but later on I removed it and I've added my net banking. So that whenever I receive a bill, auto debit won't happen. I will pay by net banking. Okay, otherwise, if you deploy resources, imagining you have 12 months of free tire and you won't get any bill for 12 months. Don't imagine like that. If you deploy two machines and leave it as it is, so after 6 months, your bill will start. If you deploy four machines, after 3 months, your bill will start. Getting my
Yeah, I
point?
observed that.
You're getting my point? The 12
Yeah.
months free tire means only one server, the 2 T2 micro size for free. For 1 hour, sorry, one instance, T2 Micro is free for 1 year. Okay, if you deploy two instances, your free tire will expire by 6 months. If you deploy four and leave it, by 3 months, your free tire will expire, and after third month, you will see the charges are applicable on your account. Okay, and so on. So every month the calculation is 730 hours, right? So 730 hours in a month, you can use EC2 instance for free. Let's say today we are doing a testing and I need 5 instance to be up and running. So if I deploy 5 servers, so out of 730 hours, you need to minus 5, because five instances is deployed. So your total number of hours applicable for free tier is 730. So it will be remove those entries from the calculation. And once your 730 hours is over, then it will start imposing normal calculation, normal bills on top of your deployments in every month. Getting my point? So
yes.
please, once your practice is done, please delete it. Don't keep the resources, because we are not doing any business out of it. We are just learning. Even if you deploy a database, if you deploy an application, or if you deploy a Docker container, or if you deploy a Kubernetes cluster, you are simply learning. You are not making any business out of it. You don't have any customer to sell your services from your portal. Imagine. So most of the people, what they will do, they will start deploying and things, and they will forget. After 6 months, they will realize that some charges are applicable on their credit cards, and what all those charges, they really don't know. Because it's an auto debit, you won't even get a SMS. Okay, the bill has been imposed. So you will see direct bills in your credit card statements. So just to avoid that, please be vigilant and deploy your resources and clean up your resources properly when you are practicing it. Right. So tomorrow what we will do, we will talk about the network basics. Okay. Reason is, as I said, the network is the key. We will start AWS networking at first stage, and then we'll talk about the rest of the components. Okay, any questions?
No, thank you. Thank
I'm
you.
Good.
Gopal?
No, sir.
No. Vamsi?
No, Srini. Yeah, I'm there. I didn't hear. Yeah,
these sessions were missed in your video, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
But however, it covered in your YouTube channel.
Oh, okay. Yeah, fine. So we'll catch up again on Monday. Tomorrow no session means Shreyas for you. Sunday night.
Okay.
Same time. We will catch up on Monday morning.
Okay.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah. So let me stop here. Let's catch up on Monday.